Good evening. Tonight, the argument that splits the Labour Party. On the left, Eric Heffer, MP for Liverpool Walton, member of the National Executive Committee. On the right, William Rodgers, MP for Stockton-on-Tees, shadow spokesman for Defence. And what's at stake is the future of the party itself. Disagreement which has now flared into open conflict between the National Executive of the entire Labour Party and the Parliamentary Labour Party. At the heart of the battle, three left-wing proposals that would weaken the powers of Labour MPs by insisting on their re-selection as candidates between elections, by taking away their sole right to choose the leader, and by denying the leader the right to control the election manifesto. What the NEC want, they say, is democratic control of the party. But to many in the Parliamentary Labour Party, it amounts to a left-wing plot. Both sides came together in the cause of party unity at a special commission of inquiry, which proposed some changes. It supported mandatory reselection of MPs. It recommended that the leader be chosen by an electoral college, and also that this college should approve the manifesto. The proposed electoral college was something new. This is how it would be composed. 50% from the parliamentary party, 25% from the trades unions, 25% from constituency parties. But overall, neither side was satisfied by the commission of inquiry. The NEC felt they hadn't gained enough. The PLP thought they were losing too much. More planning, more plotting, more meetings. Then the whole argument goes back to conference in October. In all of this, the opinion of the NEC is well known. Not so clear is the overall opinion of the Parliamentary Labour Party, the MPs. So we decided to find out what they individually think by conducting a special TVI survey. There are 267 Labour MPs. 176 of them, that's two-thirds, agreed to take part in our survey. The first of the five questions that we put to them was this. Do MPs agree that they should automatically face re-selection by their constituency party? In reply, 49 said, yes, they did agree. 40 said, no, they didn't. But a much larger number, 78, preferred a compromise, which has already been suggested, that re-selection should not be automatic, but at the discretion of the constituency party. Which seems as though most of them are prepared to bow to an inevitable process, but if possible, to minimize the pain. The second question was whether the right to choose the leader should be taken away from the parliamentary party and given to an electoral college. 63 MPs said yes to that proposal. 95, that's half as many again, said no, and 18 were undecided. So choosing the leader is not something that the PLP will lightly surrender. And so to the manifesto and who should write it. At present, officially, it's written by the shadow cabinet, or cabinet when the party's in power, and the NEC. But in practice, it's controlled by the party leader. So who should write it in future? The shadow cabinet alone, say 17 MPs. The NEC, say 39. Both together say a comfortable majority of 113, which amounts to a vote for the status quo. Next, and still on the manifesto, the proposal that it should be approved by an electoral college. What did the MPs think of that? Yes, said 43. No, said a determined 113. So on those four questions, most of the MPs who answered came down against radical change.
Before we look at the individual points in the constitutional wrangle, can I put to you, Bill Rodgers, that you wrote recently that the argument over these constitutional issues carried implications of a wider kind. You said implications of a power struggle. Who is that power struggle between?
Well, I think they do. I don't imagine that anybody in the Labour Party simply likes arguing about constitutions. At least certainly I don't, and I wish we weren't. I think the truth of the matter is there are some people in the party who want to take power away from Parliament. They want to make members of Parliament more creatures of the party caucus, and they think that this is the way of going about it. All these three new proposals are designed to shift power significantly and shift it to the left. Now, what I regret about it is that we must get on together. There must be compromises, there must be understandings. And the truth is, we've worked pretty well in the past with this very delicate balance between the party in Parliament and the party in country. And I see no reason at all why I should be upset on merit.
Is it your desire to turn members of Parliament into creatures of a party caucus, of which you're a member, Mr. Heffer?
Well, I think the first thing...
Member of both, of course.
Well, I don't quite know what Bill means by a party caucus, because the caucus could be, of course, the PLP. It depends on what he's meant by that.
Perhaps he'd like to tell us.
What I mean is that I think that either the party must be all its members, every man and woman in the party having a very considerable say, not simply general management committees, or we ought to have a reform of the National Executive Committee so it is genuinely representative. But until that happens, then the authority, the power, is not in the hands of all the members, and the tendency is to push it away from Parliament and from members of Parliament and from all those who vote for members of Parliament, for the ordinary voters of the country, into a narrow group of people who claim to be the activists.
Well, I think the first point about that, of course, is that the people do vote for a party, but then they change their votes, and therefore the people who select members of Parliament are the party members, those who are actually members of the party.
Why not all the party members? Why not every member in a party, Eric? One man, one vote. Isn't that a good principle?
If I may actually answer the point that you first raised, Llew, about is there a power struggle in the party, as far as I'm concerned, there's an attempt to widen the power base in the party. And that's what the whole argument is about. That's the constitutional arguments. It is in order to give ordinary rank-and-file party members more say in decision-making, in the question of the selection of candidates, in reselection if they feel they're not satisfied, and in making certain that their views are actually taken into consideration and carried out when you have Labour governments. It is in order to transfer, as it were, any power that we're talking about to the rank and file of the party. That is the real issue. It is to broaden democracy. Now, I personally don't see anything wrong with that, and I'm amazed that there should be such a furore in the party by those who are opposing these particular proposals. It isn't a question of making the National Executive the dominant body, and there was a lot of rubbish talked, actually, at one stage, and it's not being talked at the moment, thank goodness, although I've no doubt it'll come up again, that what the National Executive wanted to do was to bring in an East European communist-type dictatorship. People know that is not true. People in the party know that's not true, and the general public know it's not true. And I don't
know. Do you know it's not true, Mr. Rodgers?
Yes, I would never have said that. I mean, what worries me is the National Executive Committee not only has a power and wants more, but is not itself representative. Now, if Eric's principle were to carry, not only would we have every man and woman in the party having a vote in the main decisions of the party, not simply the general management committees, we would have a National Executive Committee which had a section genuinely representative of the grassroots of the party workers, and we'd equally have a section which was elected by members of Parliament. Now, that's what accountability really means, what democracy really means. Now, that's what I'm puzzled about. I mean, Eric's own position. All right, we've taken the lid off Pandora's box. All right, we're on to constitutional questions, even though many of us prefer to have been arguing about what's wrong with Mrs. Thatcher, and goodness, is a great deal. But if we've got the lid off Pandora's box, Eric, why don't you want a National Executive Committee more genuinely representative of the whole party? Why don't we start by reforming it?
You see, I think the National Executive Committee of the party is pretty representative. But of course,
how many members of Parliament
always,
elected by members of Parliament?
There can always be an improvement in any
How
body.
Many local councils, now, Eric?
If you're going to badger me, Bill, I'm afraid I don't intend to be badgered, and I don't want to get in that sort of setup.
I want to discuss
the matter rationally and intelligently, but if you want to go on badgering me, that's all right, then I'm not prepared to get into that scene.
Well, I don't want to badger you, Eric, but I want to ask you, how many local councillors there are on the National Executive Committee, and do you think there are sufficient?
Well, we haven't yet got to the stage, as far as I understand in this discussion, about the composition of the National Executive of the party. But I would tell you this, Bill, I am elected to the National Executive by constituency delegates, who, as you know, at their constituency parties, go through the lists of the candidates and decide who they shall vote for, and who actually put up then their delegate to vote for particular people. I regard that as extremely representative.
Okay, gentlemen.
And I regard my constituency on the National Executive as being one that's probably as representative, probably more representative than most constituencies on the National Executive.
Right, can I put to you, Eric Heffer, the point that I think was contained in Bill Rogers' first answer, that by you're in danger of turning MPs into delegates from their constituency parties, who would be terrified of stepping out of line of party policy at all. And isn't that fundamentally against the principles of parliamentary democracy as we've understood it for a long time? And if it is against it, is that a bad thing?
No, you see, the situation is changing, I think. We have to understand that members of political parties no longer feel that they've just got to be part of a machine to get somebody elected to Parliament. They are members of a party and they want to play some part in shaping the policy of that party and in seeing that the policy of that party is actually carried through. And so often, unfortunately, they have seen people elected to Parliament who then have tended to ignore the views and feelings of the rank and file. And let's be quite honest about it, the whole thing has emerged in the last few years because of people like Reg Prentice, because of what has happened in, and there's a list as long as your arm of people of that kind who've deserted the party, who've used the party, and the party members feel this has not got to happen in future, and therefore they want methods of greater control, if you like. But I've never heard anybody saying that members of parliament have got to be delegates and they've got to faithfully carry out instructions from their constituency parties.
Is there a danger of that?
Well, I think there's a very real danger. Now, I think if members of parliament became puppets on the string, we've all got responsibilities. We have responsibilities, yes, I agree with Eric, to our party. We've got responsibilities to our constituents, and thank goodness we have responsibilities to our consciences as well, because if we became other people's creatures, we wouldn't be worthy, worthy of being members of parliament. Now, I think that 99 times out of 100, despite Eric's list as long as his arm, members of parliament, Labour members, get on very well with their constituency parties.
Absolutely.
But the plain fact is that when they're in parliament, they are only there not because of their parties which selected them, but because very many of thousands of people actually voted for them. And their job is to express the views of their constituents as well as respond to their own consciences.
No, that is a
point. And if they had to stand on their heads at the dictate of the National Executive Committee or any body, it would be anti-parliamentary. It would be very damaging to the whole concept of parliamentary
yes,
democracy.
Yes, but that's a constitutional nonsense, you know, Bill, in this sense, that we are not elected to Parliament as individuals. We are elected as members of a political party. And when people vote for us in an election...
We have a list system here, Eric. They may have a party label as well, which I agree is important.
Well, I was going to say, in the old days, of course, you didn't have your party next to your name. But we have changed that in this country, and now you have Bill Rodgers, Labour. Eric Heffer, Labour. That didn't used to happen. And we now stand quite clearly, you know, the reality is has always been that, but now it's recognised by the fact that on the ballot form, you now have the party that you represent. And we are in Parliament because we represent a political party.
I know you're coming back on that, but let me move it on a little bit. Can we turn to the election of the party leader? And the idea that this should be taken out of the direct hands of the PLP and referred to a electoral college. Why does this system need to be changed, the old system? And Mr. Duffy of the Engineers has suggested, for instance, that it produced perfectly good leaders in the past. I mean, it had Mr. Attlee, Mr. Milson, and Mr. Callaghan. So hasn't it worked very well for Labour in the past?
Well, because something has always happened in the past, it doesn't mean to say that it should always happen in the future.
But what's been wrong with it Eric Heffer? That's what I'm asking.
Well, I'll tell you what happened last time. When we had the last leadership election, there was a tremendous feeling on the part of constituency parties in particular that the leader ought to have been elected on the basis of them also having some say in who the leader should be. Incidentally, the Liberal Party, as you know, now do this, and therefore it isn't something tremendously revolutionary, and in fact, most of our continental social democratic parties that we're in association with in the Socialist International also have the election of the leader very different from the way we do. Now, there was a real upsurge of feeling and quite a lot of discontent, particularly in constituency Labour parties, that we don't have a voice, and also that those who don't have members of Parliament didn't have a voice. And some of my colleagues in the House of Commons actually took their ballot paper to their CLPs and allowed the CLPs to fill it in. Now, I don't think that's the way to do it. I think the way to do it is to ensure that all CLPs have a vote, that every member of parliament has a vote, and also that the trade unions have a vote. And that is, it would then be representative of the party as a whole.
But you make the point precisely, Eric, that in fact most members of parliament in exercising their vote have allowed for all sorts of circumstances. There are lots of people who didn't, thank goodness, give their ballot papers to somebody else to mark, but who took account of the views of their constituency parties and weighed them in the balance. But the fact is that we who live day to day in the House of Commons with those who grow up amongst us are very, very good judges of who's going to be best.
It isn't
an elitist view. If you choose from amongst your peers because you know somebody, because they've got to lead you day to day in the House of God, that's not elitist at all. It's a simply common sense of exercise of your own judgment. Now, what could happen, what might be the result of spreading the election of the leader, is that we would get somebody foisted on the Parliamentary Labour Party who had to lead us day to day, appear in the House of Commons day to day, who was not acceptable at all. Now, all right, if Eric wants to change the system and go over to a continental system of a leader of the party in the House of Commons or wherever it might be, and a separate party chairman, there's a lot to be said for that if we want a major structural change. But whoever acts in the House day to day must be somebody who's acceptable to members. But it simply won't work. It's against human nature to work if he isn't.
If I can, I would like to move away then from the strict constitutional points that we've been making and arguing about to perhaps the broader philosophical points, because there are other things that worry you going on in the party, are there not, Mr. Rodgers? There's the special conference of the other week where they decided on renationalisation without compensation. You're worried about the neutralisation sort of philosophy that seems to be running through some of the foreign policy thinking within the party. So therefore, there's a philosophical debate going on.
Yes, I think there's and I'm very worried indeed about this extraordinary decision made yesterday in relation to the IRA, which is highly irresponsible. I can't believe that Eric really supported it. Now, I'm worried for a number of reasons. I mean, partly, quite frankly, because as a long-standing member of the Labour Party, 34 years since I first joined in Liverpool, I want us to win in another election and to be fit to exercise power. And I'm very worried indeed that the country doesn't vote for extremist parties. They didn't vote for the Communist Party, they didn't vote for the Workers' Revolutionary Party last time. And I'm afraid we'll increasingly look like a party which really simply doesn't stand for what ordinary working people most want. Our policies will not be relevant to them. Now, the other possibility is that we shall have a manifesto which is crammed with things which I know, and I think Eric in his heart knows, no Labour government could conceivably do in its period in office. No Labour government will nationalise, renationalise without compensation. That's against the whole idea of democracy, and we wouldn't be elected to power if we did. So let's not put into our manifesto, which is what we're beginning to do, things which will offend against the very principle that Eric is worried about, having a manifesto which is not carried out, in my case, because I believe it couldn't be carried out.
Do you believe these things in your heart of hearts, Mr. Heffer?
Before we go any further, can I answer the point? It's quite clear that Bill hasn't read the resolution that was carried at yesterday's National Executive in relation to the prisons in Northern Ireland. And to suggest that it was supporting the IRA is a gross distortion. That's what some of the press have said.
I've read the resolution,
and it isn't
Eric,
true.
That's my judgment.
Well, it isn't true. It may be your judgment, but your judgment is wrong.
Mr. Because Callaghan didn't like it either.
Well, of course he didn't. But one of those one of those who sat on the committee, who actually went through it with us, who in fact did not vote against it and was instrumental with me in getting changes in the resolution, was Shirley Williams. Shirley Williams didn't oppose the resolution.
She didn't vote for it.
She voted for it. She did not oppose it because there was no final vote on the Home Policy Committee. And knowing Shirley, she always makes it absolutely clear when she's in opposition to something. That's the one thing there's many things I like about Shirley.
Mrs. Williams in absentia, as it were?
Yes, but it is important to get it understood that that resolution was not the resolution of a bunch of crackpots on the sort of extremist wing of the party who were wanting to back up the IRA. It clearly says in there that we're opposed to terrorism from whichever quarter it comes. So it is not true to say that, and you shouldn't say that sort of thing. Jim didn't like the resolution, that's perfectly true, and he made quite clear he didn't agree with it. Now, on these other issues.
Please.
What are we suggesting? Take the question of compensation. The party has passed a resolution exactly in the same terms as carried by the Trade Union Congress. No different, exactly the same resolution. And we have, in fact, set up a joint committee to look into the question of how it could be done in a practical way. So it isn't the end of the question in relation to compensation.
We are nearing the end, Mr. Heffer. Can I put... Do you really believe, though, that what I suppose one might call for a better... for a better cliché, a full red-blooded socialist programme would be voted for by the British people?
Well, I'm certain that the situation we're in the country at the moment with this disastrous government, and I totally agree with Bill, I mean, our entire energies should be spent in fighting this government in order to get them out in a democratic way at the earliest possible moment. I'm convinced that the people of this country will understand full well that the only answer is, in fact, a socialist programme. It depends on what you mean by full-blooded. If you mean sort of crackpot proposals, I'm not in favour of crackpot proposals, and neither are those coming from the National Executive. Crackpot proposals, in my view, they are very sensible, intelligent proposals, and I think they do give an alternative economic answer to the Tories, and people really ought to read what we say and what we actually come out with and not interpret it in the way they are.
Bill Rodgers, very quickly, if people like you lose this debate within the Labour Party, what will you do?
Well, I believed all my political life in freedom and social justice, and I shall continue for fighting for those. I hope it will be in the Labour Party, because the Labour Party is still, in my view, the best vehicle to carry them forward and to change our society with parliamentary democracy.
Might it not be in the Labour Party?
Well, I hope it won't be, because I think that it's the Labour Party which can be the vehicle. But we must face the fact that there are very, very many people in the country who will not vote Labour next time and will not continue to be active in the Labour Party unless it does believe very firmly in the values of freedom as well as the values of greater equality. Well,
gentlemen, thank you very much. There we must leave it. I'm not at all sure that you actually needed a chairman or a referee. I am sure, however, that the debate will continue at least until the Labour Party conference in October. From you, from me, from TVI, good night.